Okay. Two black leaders. Okay, during this period, you have two different leaders arise with very different views. Booker T. Washington and W.B. Du Bois. Now, Booker T. Washington was born to a slave mother and a white father, who was the owner, in 1856. But his abilities and drive took him far past the limitations that others tried to place on him. He fought to get an education at Hampton Institute, which he graduated from at 16. He believed in hard work, study, hygiene, morality, self-discipline, and self-reliance in large amounts. Upon graduation, he built the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama. Where such prominent men as George Washington Carver graduated from. And basically, George Washington Carver worked on all these things that could be done with the peanut. Why? Because, guys, peanuts revive the soil. Oh, like cotton just strips the soil of nutrients. And peanuts and legumes return some of those minerals and everything back into the soil. Now, it used to be people would grow the peanuts, call them goober peas, and, you know, it worked practically nothing. Does anybody know one of the things that George Washington Carver invented that you probably use at least once or maybe twice a week? Peanut butter. He also developed like how you could use the oil for cosmetics and all this different stuff. Very clever. Very intelligent guy. Basically, he built Tuskegee Institute. He got very little support from the state, so he had to fund his school through speaking tours, where he called upon blacks to cast down their bucket where you are, cast it down and making friends of all the people of all the races by whom we're surrounded, cast it down in agriculture, mechanics, in commerce, in domestic service, in all the professions. He wrote the book Up From Slavery. He was America's first race advisor to Theodore Roosevelt. Here you can see patience and self-control needed to solve the race problem. Basically, he wanted to lift everybody up. He was known as the Great Accommodator. Basically, like in some of these speeches, when asked about blacks and whites, Booker T. Washington would say, well, they'll be like the fingers are to the glove. And that, because remember, it's got to talk to these white audiences and get money from them to support this stuff, that the improvement of blacks, some of the whites might see as, and he said, no, look, we're as the fingers to the glove. In other words, we're all in the same hand, but we're all separate.
Okay, here's your check.
Now, this, of course, was the total opposite of the way W.B. Du Bois saw things. Basically, he was a towering black intellectual, scholar, and political thinker. He said that Washington's strategy would only serve to perpetuate white oppression. Indeed, Du Bois advocated political action and a civil rights agenda. He helped found the NAACP. In addition, he argued that the social change could be accomplished by developing the small group of college-educated blacks that he called the Talented Ten. In other words, when, let's say we only have 20 students in here. Guys, some of y'all might get C's, some of y'all might get B's, some of y'all get A minuses. I'm going to take the two best and lead them away from the contamination and filth of the world. Because I'm going to make these guys, because they're my top students, and I'm going to make them so bright, so rapier sharp, that nobody could deny that blacks are somehow less. And basically, he believed that Booker T. Washington was a leader of the black community and white size only. So if we put these into the civil rights leaders of the 50s and 60s of Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, who do you think is more like Malcolm X? Du Bois. With Martin Luther King Jr. kind of being more, hey, everybody. You ready? Agrarian revolt. Okay, guys, if you wanted problems, the farmers had them. Basically, since the Civil War, farmers have been continually frustrated by events outside of their control and the apparent lack of government to address any of their problems. There's a huge decline in commodity prices from 1870 to 1898. Basically, it's just going down and down and down. And the harder you work, it don't matter. Because crop price is going down. Oh, and by the way, if you grow more crops, that's going to make the price go down even further. Now, why do we have such a surplus? Well, first off, domestically, we're overproducing. Technologies like the McCormick Reaper and the Iron Plow made harvesting more crops possible. And the flood on the market of goods drove the prices down. Also, further complicating our domestic overproduction is the fact that we also now have agriculture from other countries flooding into America. Who else are we going to blame? We're going to blame the railroads and middlemen. Because, you know, these are the closest available targets. And they're incredibly frustrated. The railroads would charge the farmers high railroad rates. Oh, my goodness. See, I was just getting all excited. I'm getting ready to ask y'all to join the revolution.